let's start with options. The options here are from the point of view of using WebRTC. So at the end, if you are using another language or other framework, whatever, they are going to use these three options. Maybe you are not doing some of them, but the framework will use one of these. So we have the Android Web View. We are going to see that, the native the Java API for WebRTC and the C++ API. Let's start with the Android Web View. This the Web View that is based on Chrome is added to Android some time ago. It replaced the old Web View that was already available in Android using WebKit. And this new Web View uses Chrome. And it has WebRTC support. It was introduced on Android 4.4, but the problem with that is that it was introduced using a very old version from Chrome, and it was not supporting well WebRTC. So at the end, it's only usable in Lollipop and higher. So the good thing of the on new devices is that it is updated very frequently with every version of Chrome. So is one of the options, but it has some limitations. The problem with the working only on Lollipop, at the end, there are a lot of devices that you are not targeting if you are using the Web View. Lollipop and newer versions are only like the 50% of the market share of Android. The other thing is that the Web View is an external component on Android, so it's updated outside your application. That means that it's a good thing, maybe, but also it can break your app. You don't control when the Web View is updated. That means that sometimes people can be running your application in a Web View that you have not tested, or something, or maybe you need to update the Web View and people is not doing that, so you cannot force that. And the other thing is that all the video views are inside the Web View. So all the Web View applications, everything is contained on the Web View. So if you want to mix the video views with other components, UI components from Android, it's something that is not easy to do. As alternative for the Web View, this is the most popular one, that is Crosswalk. It's an Intel open source project that they compile Chrome, and they provide the Chromium build for you to use as the Web View. The good things about that, the pros are that they have 4.0 support, so it works on more devices. You can decide if you can embed the binary inside your application, so you can decide when to update. That is a good thing. It's a good thing, depending on your use case. And you have always the latest version of Chromium. That is also a good thing. As cons, you have that as you embed the binary inside your application, the binary size is going to increase a lot. That is, Chromium is a very big project. And also, that is a good thing and a bad thing. If you manually upgrade the version of Chrome, the thing is Google can force you to update your application at some point if there is some security issue or something like that. Maybe sometimes this can happen and you have to update, or your application can be removed from Google Play. So let's go to the second option, that is the Java APIs. WebRTC already provides some bindings for Java, so it's something that you already can use. The good thing with that is that you have access, all the video is rendered using native views, so you can integrate all the UI from the Android UI with your video views, so you can mix them and create your application as you want. And also it's manually updated. The problem here is that the WebRTC is a big project, so there are pre-builds available. Pristine.io was one of the most popular ones, but it's outdated now. They are not maintaining anymore. So, and the other option is to compile it from the source. That is not as easy as I think that other people is going to talk about that today. And for example, for Android, it doesn't compile on Mac or Windows, so you need a dedicated box using Ubuntu to compile it. So it's not an easy thing to maintain. And the other thing is the other, this is our other things about the native Java the Java API. That the problem is that the API is more complex than JavaScript, mainly because it's Java and the language is different. But there are other things in from Android that make that a bit more complicated. Also, using that approximation, for example, the binary size is also bigger. It's like integrating the web view. For example, Pristine.io, when you create something with Pristine.io, you have the 20 megabytes of APK size. Here in the Java option, you have all other alternatives like Topbox and other platform providers that they provide the Java API that you can use, and they just track all the peer connection API, so you don't have to care about that. And also, they do all the work doing all the signaling and everything there. And the last option, is the C++ API. WebRTC is done in C++, so you can access all the APIs in C++. That makes sense if your code base is already in C++. That is not maybe a common thing, but for portability is a good option. You still need Java access for the capturing rendering. In Java, most of the APIs are most of the APIs are in Java. So you need GNI to access to the camera, or there are new APIs, but it depends on the version. So at the end, it's complicated. But the good thing with that is you have the maximum portability. The same code in C++ can run in iOS, Android, desktop, whatever, in other platforms. But it's very complex to maintain. The C++ API is not as stable as the others. So they are changing the API. And sometimes, if you want to upgrade to the new version of WebRTC, you have to modify your code. So it's hard to maintain. Let's start with using the Java API to create an application. This is the fun part, I think, at least for me. The setup. We create a single activity application using Android Studio. The thing is to start with doing some using WebRTC. We need to decide something about the signaling mechanism. You can use WebSocket, PubNav. This is up to you. You can use SMS if you want. This doesn't matter. But the thing is, for example, in the example, I'm going to use Socket.io. That is very easy to set up a server with that. To get WebRTC, For the example, the easiest way is to get a pre-build, like Pristine.io. You add that to your grader file, and you already have all the Java, all the APIs needed to use WebRTC. It's the only line that you have to add. The problem with that is not updated. The last version is from December last year, so that's an issue, maybe. Don't forget to add the permissions needed to access the camera, to access to internet, and access to the microphone. And we can start with the WebRTC initialization. WebRTC is a C++ code. So at the end, this is the thing that I was commenting before, that you need to access to all the APIs in Java. So there is this initial method, the static method, that you pass the context to access to all the hardware APIs, something like that, and also to decide if you want to use audio and video and if you want to use hardware acceleration here. This is something that is needed for all from the C++ to access to the Java APIs. With this, you create the peer connection factory. That is the object that is used to create the peer connection. So next step is the video capturer. The good thing is with WebRTC, they already provide all the setup to start capturing, so you don't have to know how to use the camera, APIs, or something like that. So it's as easy as these two lines. You can get the name of the front-facing device, and you can create the video capturer using the name. They already provide implementations for the camera API, so you don't have to deal with that. Also, they added some weeks ago the possibility to create a video capturer using screen sharing. So you can screen share the view from the application. So there are some interesting use cases using that. That is a good thing. But it's not available in the Pristine.io compilation yet. I mean, they are not maintaining it. So here is the line to create the video capturer. And the next step is to add this video capture to something. In WebRTC, we have the concept of the media stream. That is what we use to send the video to the other peer. So we need to add in the stream two tracks, the audio track and the video track. When we create the tracks, we set up the video source using the video capture that we have created before. So after that, we create the audio source and create the audio track, and we have the local media stream. With this local media stream, we can start showing the preview of the local video in the local in the application. For the rendering, here in the to see the preview of the local video on the other peer, there are several options available in WebRTC. They already provide these two. GL Surface View and Surface View Renderer. The difference between them is the GL Surface View is a common GL Surface View that is being used by all the renderers in the same conference. So you can overlap the video there, but you have to add the renderers in the order that you want to put them in the screen, and all of them share the same Surface View. Maybe it's okay for some applications, but there is the other Surface View renderer that you use a different view for every video. So you can place the views in the layout in any way. The problem with this last one is more flexible, but the Surface View views in Android have layout issues. At the end, the implementation of Surface View in Android is done in they are not really views, they are like windows over the real window. So maybe you can have some layout issues. That's why WebRTC provides all the APIs to create your own renderer. So at the end, if you have issues with one of them, you can create your own renderer using texture view, or maybe, for example, if you have a game, you can integrate the texture or the video frame inside your game. It's something that you have the possibility to do it. So in the sample code, in this example, we are going to use the GL Surface View. We get the Surface View from the layout. And at the end, we create the renderers. This is the other peer renderer that we are creating first to cover all the GL Surface View. And we are creating our preview renderer, covering only one part, one square in the view. And if we add the renderer to the local video track, we start seeing our preview. So with that, we have half of the way done, I think. The next thing is to create the peer connection. Here it's not tricky, but the thing is, you usually see the peer connection. When you create the peer connection, people add some stand server from Google, but at the end, you need to provide your TARN and STAN servers. It's something that you need for your deployment. If you don't have that, the peer connection, maybe it works in the local network, but this is very probable that it's not going to work outside your local network. Because at the end, sometimes there are firewalls or NATs that makes you have issues connecting from one peer to the other. So this is very important. So this is where the other third parties are important, because, for example, Topbox, that we provide all these things, so you don't have to make your own, or to deploy your own. So we create the peer connection using the peer connection factory that we have created before, and we add our local stream to the peer connection. That way, when the peer connection is connected to the other peer, they will see our video. And here start the SDP negotiation. The SDP negotiation is the same that is on JavaScript. It's a bit more verbose, because the way that you have to do it on Java, but you have to implement the peer connection observer and SDP observer to get notifications. They are the listeners to get the notifications from peer connection when something happens. We are sending on our sample code the SDP over socket.io. That is our signaling protocol. And this is the last step to have media flowing. You have to remember also to add when you get the stream from the other peer, to add the renderer there to see the video from the other peer. This is the diagram of the how the SDP negotiation works. It seems very complicated, but it's not so much. At the end, both clients connect to the server with using Socket.io, and the server decides to send the create offer, that is the start message, to one of them. So one of them, is, using the peer connection API, creates the offer and sets the local description in this peer connection object. Then that generates the offer SDP that you send to the other peer. The server is just relaying the message, and the client too, when it receives the message, sets the remote description and creates the answer that travels to the other way, and they have the information of the codex of both sides. So in this process, there are also other things that are called candidates, that whenever you start doing the SDP negotiation, peer connection automatically starts trying to guess which IPs you have. So all the candidates are options to connect to your host. So if you have several TAN servers, maybe you would see more candidates here because you have more options to connect to you or something like that. And at the end of this process, we have the media established after this. The server is something that maybe if you are doing Android development is something that maybe is something that you are not used to do, but the server is something as easy as that. This is a Socket.io server, only 30 lines of code. It doesn't have any kind of logic. It only, when there is a message, an offer message, it sends the message to the other peers. Answer, the same, and the candidates, the same. So, and for the first one, it sends the create offer that to start the process. The server is very easy. At the end, also the application is also very easy. It's very small, 260 lines of code for the Android application. That is the minimum thing needed to have video working. There is no error handling on other things, but it's something that is easy to understand. And the server is very small, as you have seen. Here you can find all the source code that I uploaded here to GitHub, so feel free to use it and to test it. And some Android tips for to finalize. Things that the binary size of the application using WebRTC is very big. I recommend to use the split mechanism, creating different APKs for every architecture. At the end, the size is something important for the final application if you're creating something, a commercial application or something like that. Remember to stop the camera and the microphone. This is something that the WebRTC is not doing for you. WebRTC doesn't have access to the events of the application. This is usually handled by the activity. So you have to take care of stopping the camera when you go to the background or stopping the microphone when you receive a phone call. These are important things to remember. Audio routing, this is something that it seems easy when you connect the headset or a Bluetooth headset, something like that. It's not as easy if you look at the implementation of the WebRTC application, that is the example code that provided with WebRTC. It's not as easy. There are a lot of edge cases, and it's better to look at an implementation and do something similar. And at the end, if you want to try new codecs like the BP9 or H.264, by default, it's using BP8. But there is no easy way to select them, so you have to, at the end, modify the SDP and reorder the codex there to use one or the other. That's maybe in the future is something is a bit easier, but now it's a bit complicated. And that's